I'd like to call to order the Thousand Oaks City Council meeting of March 22nd. If you would all please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, in what has become an all too common occurrence, the world was struck once again today by terrorism. And in honor of those lives that were lost and those that were injured, I would ask that we take a moment just to remember those folks. So a moment of silence, please. Thank you very much. All right, roll call. This will be, let me introduce to you our new city clerk, Ms. Cynthia Rodriguez. This is her first meeting here in the city of Thousand Oaks, and she's going to call roll.
Councilmember Fox.
I am here.
Councilmember Adam.
Here.
Councilmember McCoy.
Present.
Councilmember Bill De La Pena.
Present.
Mayor Price.
And I am here. So item number four, request for continuance. We do have one item that's being continued, a public hearing. Item 8A, the appeal of the Planning Commission decision, the appellant or the applicant being Academy Road LLC, and that is being moved to April 12th of 2016. And for that, I'm going to need a motion. Anyone? Mr. McCoy?
I make a motion that we accept the staff recommendation for 8A.
Okay, we have a motion to continue item 8A. Any discussion on the motion? No. Vote, please.
The motion passes 5-0.
Thank you very much. And we are on to item number five, special presentations and announcements. I'm going to head down to the podium. All right, first, our first special presentation tonight. I have the honor of recognizing an individual that is retiring after 35 years of service to the public here with the Ventura County Fire Protection District. And will Battalion Chief Scott Schuster and Fire Chief Ted Smith join me at the podium? They're already here. Never sneak up on a cop, please.
That would be a retired cop.
Thank you. All right, so I know just a little bit about Scott. Scott decided while he was a student here at Newbury Park High School. So that was probably in about 1976?
75.
Okay. That he wanted to be a fireman. And he then became a cadet, a fire cadet. And his career in fire service started then as a seasonal firefighter. And in 1981, Scott became a full-time firefighter. He moved from fire engineer in 1985 to fire captain in 1988 and then to battalion chief in 2010. And here we are in 2016, it is now. And he's finishing up 35 years of public service. And I think our fire chief, Ted Smith, probably has a few more things that he can add. Ted?
Honorable Mayor, thank you. Honorable Council, City Manager. I'm going to speak from the heart. I don't have a script. But I will tell you this, you can tell Scott's affiliation with the fire department started in 1975. Mine started in 1978. Scott and I, we mirrored a lot of similar paths. He's a hell of a lot smarter than I am, but Scott has always been one of those guys that's willing to be there for you for counseling, for mentorship, and for leadership. I've turned to Scott on many a time since I've promoted through the ranks for guidance and for counseling. He's a dear, dear friend. He's a good command officer. It takes a special person to be able to tell people what to do, when to do it, and make the right decision in a very expeditious manner that has to be a correct decision. Scott has done that successfully through his career. What we didn't mention, Mayor, is that Scott also was on a federal incident management team that handled large wildfires all across the country, mostly in the state of California, but that we went out of state. Scott's a qualified operations section chief, which is the one that controls all the pieces of moving parts on a wildfire or a major incident. It doesn't have to be. It's all risk. Scott, from me and from the fire chief and your fellow compadres here that came out, our deputy chief is here, and our line personnel that are on duty today, they honor Scott in the way by showing up and saying thank you. Ellen, his beautiful wife, is here. His wife, his daughter Lauren, his son Ryan, who now is a firefighter with us, firefighter paramedic, thank you for letting us have your dad. It's been an honor for us to serve with your dad. Scott, I am going to miss you so much. Stop. You are a dear, dear friend, and thank you, and God bless you on your next adventure. Scott manages his money well, and I think he's got some motorhome time coming. So, yeah. Ellen, God bless you. But anyway, I'm going to give you a hug.
Go ahead, Scott. Take the mic.
I'll be brief. I'd just like to thank you, Mr. Mayor, the council staff. The city staff has always been so wonderful to work with, and especially in my last few years here as a battalion chief. I was just talking with Jay, and how he'll miss me calling him at 3 in the morning because I learned that he answers his phone at 3 in the morning. And of course, all the other wonderful staff, Mr. Mitnick, Tim, all of you have just been very gracious to me and a pleasure to work with. I'd like to thank all my coworkers for coming out at the dinner hour and wishing me well. Saturday morning is going to be a little unusual because, as Mr. Fox and I'm sure Mayor Price would attend, that time you realize you're not going to go on an emergency anymore when you've been doing it as many years as we all have. It's a little different, but it's a whole new adventure. And I have a lovely granddaughter that couldn't be here this evening because she's teething, apparently. And I'm looking forward to being a full-time grandfather. So, again, thank you all so much. Very kind.
Scott, I can tell you that there is life after public service. Having been retired now for a year, you're going to enjoy it. We want to recognize your service for the last 35 years and wish you and your family a happy and healthy retirement. We have for you a nice certificate here.
Well, thank you so much, Mr. Mayor.
And we'd be honored if you'd step up front and allow the entire council.
You know, Mr. Mayor, let me just, I can't let this pass. We have some retirements from time to time, but I did want to just comment for the greater public. I have a little expertise in this area, and I can tell you that we are so blessed and well served by our firefighters from Ventura County. I've said many times at public events, you are likely not going to remember the name on the back of their turnout coat or the number on the fire engine, but you're going to remember how they treated you and your family when you called in your time of need. And we are so, so fortunate to have absolute great professionals out here in Thousand Oaks and in the entire Ventura County. Scott, just wish you the best. 35 years of service, distinguished service. You've earned it. And I'm glad you're retiring healthy with your family, and I just wish you the very, very best.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations.
It's up to you.
Hey, you've been called.
Hey, you want us all down there?
Yeah.
I'll let you leave.
We gotta go over there?
We'll let you guys leave.
All you.
Okay. Family first.
Bring it in. Never.
Hmm? Yeah, that's in Maple.
Right. Say something.
All right, next I'd like to invite Robin Borikov to join me at the podium.
Call me anytime, though. If you ever need any reference.
There she is. Hello.
Hi.
Again.
Fancy meeting.
How are you?
Here.
Tonight we are honored to present a proclamation for April as Autism Awareness Month. Autism is a lifelong developmental challenge associated with significant alteration of an individual's ability to learn. A child is diagnosed with autism every 20 minutes. Increasing research to better understand, diagnose, and properly treat autism is a goal of the Autism Society. The Autism Society launched a nationwide effort to promote autism awareness, inclusion, and self-determination for all, and assure that each person with autism is provided the opportunity to achieve the highest possible quality of life. To promote autism awareness, you are encouraged to become partners in the movement toward acceptance and appreciation. And we have for you a proclamation, and I will offer you the opportunity to make any comments that you'd like.
I would love to. Thank you so
Please
much,
do.
Joel. Hi, some of you know me as a character I created called Fairy Queen Flutterby, teaching through the art of storytelling. But tonight I'm wearing my different hat, actually my different face. I'm Robin Flutterby Borikov, and I advocate for ASD and all special needs adults. And what I've done is created a charity that has a program where we're going to be implementing a program for people to learn how to forge relationships. Relationships are really important for all of us. And if you have happy, healthy relationships, despite your issues, you need less services.
Thank you very much. Let's get a quick photo if we could here.
Okay.
Step out here.
Okay.
I'd like to invite Denise Belko, the ambassador to the Donate Life program, to the podium. Hello. April 2016 is DMV Donate Life California Month. Organ tissue, marrow, and blood donations are life-giving acts of compassion to those in need. Millions of lives are saved each year and healed by donors. Over 10 million Californians have signed up with the state-authorized Donate Life California Registry to ensure their wishes to be organ and tissue donors are honored. In the spirit of giving, the decision to donate is not restricted by age or medical condition. California residents can sign up with the Donate Life California Registry when applying for or renewing their California driver's license or ID cards at the Department of Motor Vehicles. In honor of this program, April 2016 is designated as DMV Donate Life California Month. Denise, did you have anything to add? Or anyone from your group here? No? That's fine too. But, oh yeah, if we could, TOTV, if you could put the
Show the photos, please.
Thank you. This is the Donate Life float that Denise and the organization, and I imagine you got to work on it as well, that was in this past year's Rose Parade. And I think this is the third year that you've done a float. Is that correct? Beautiful float. And?
And there we have our...
our very own Claudia Bill de la Pena photo, in the photo there as well with her son. I'm sure that's Luca, though. That's Dante? Oh, okay. And, of course, we have a proclamation in honor of your efforts, and we'd like to present to you. All right?
Mr. Mayor, if I may.
Yes, please.
The reason you showed the photo with the Belko family and myself and my son Dante was because the Belko family had invited the city of Thousand Oaks for the third year in a row to place a rose in memory of Denise, her son Michael, who passed away a few years ago and was able, through his wish to donate his organs, was able to help, I believe, 10 persons with some of the organs and tissue and other things. And I think that is remarkable. And so my son and I were very, very honored to represent the city of Thousand Oaks. Thank you.
Thank you very much. For our next presentation, I would like to ask Larry McKinney, Fleet Services Supervisor, to join me at the podium. Larry's got some exciting news that he'd like to share with the council and the folks who are here with us tonight and those at home.
Thank you, Mayor. City Council.
How are you?
Good. How about you? Take it away. Anyway, the city's Fleet Services Division, we maintain over 650 vehicles and equipment, and including generators, utility trucks, and heavy equipment, and transit buses. And recently, we were ranked the 20th Green Fleet in North America. Wow. And you know, that by the government green fleet and government, or this, anyway, the federal, okay, the government green fleet award is open to all federal, state, and local government fleets and recognized public fleets for leadership, effective planning, and fleet utilization. The award recognized the city for its use of alternative fuel vehicles, which makes up almost 60% of our fleet. You know, the largest percentage of alternative fuel vehicles of any public agency in Ventura County. The city also is recognized for incorporating new technologies, staying informed about green fleet news, applying for grants, support recycled green parts purchasing and facility improvements and maintenance practices. The awards were announced at the National Association of Fleet Administrators Institute of Expo, published in the American City and County Magazine. 38,000 public fleets in North America are eligible for this award. So I think that's a pretty good accomplishment, being named the 20th Green Fleet in North America. So on behalf of the 100 best fleets in North America and American City Counties Magazine, it's my pleasure to present you with the Green Fleet Award.
Outstanding.
get a quick picture or not?
You know,
excuse me.
No, go right ahead. For those who've been in public service, and I know, well, fire trucks are always nice and shiny, but police cars, not so much, where I come from anyway. But we do have a remarkable fleet of vehicles. I've had the opportunity to go out there to the Municipal Service Center and work on some of them on an occasion, and I marveled at not just the vehicles themselves, but the shop in which they're serviced. Not only do we have a green fleet, but we have one of the cleanest municipal service centers and shops I have ever seen. These guys do a tremendous job of keeping that fleet on the road, and it certainly is, as you mentioned, 60% of our vehicles are alternate fuel vehicles, so we are certainly doing our part here. So thank you very much for your efforts and all the people that work with you.
Thank you.
For our final special presentation this evening, I want to invite Cabrillo Music Theater Artistic Director Lewis Wilkenfeld to come down to the podium. And as he comes down here, I just want to say that as most, if not all of you, have probably heard by now, this past Monday, Cabrillo Music Theater announced that they will be suspending productions effective July 24th of 2016 at the conclusion of their 2015-2016 season. The City of Thousand Oaks has been a proud partner with Cabrillo Music Theater, a tremendous community asset that has served the Conejo Valley for more than 22 years. I, as well as the entire City Council, want to thank you, Lewis, and everyone at Cabrillo Music Theater for 22 wonderful years of entertainment, and we wish everyone well with all their future endeavors. And with that, I will turn the mic over to you.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, and I want to take a moment to acknowledge the folks who really deserve that. It's our board of directors, many of whom are right here tonight, and they're the ones who've been keeping Cabrillo Music Theater going for 22 years. Before I talk about Children of Eden, our upcoming show, I just want to remind everyone that our summer spectacular, oh, don't lose the script.
Get out of the way.
Yeah. Our summer spectacular show is Disney's The Little Mermaid. And here it is. And we will be performing this in the Kavli Theater in July, as we did with Mary Poppins. We will be doing this show before anybody else around. And it's going to have our outreach. We're going to have our animal rescue program going on during the summer. It's going to be an event to captivate the entire community. So make your plans now to be with us for our finale of The Little Mermaid. But I want to talk about Children of Eden. That's why I'm here tonight. This is the show you don't know, but you're going to walk out and be grateful that this community has a company like Cabrillo and a show like this. It is remarkable. And before I tell you about the show, I want to tell you about our performers tonight. Natalia Vivino went to high school at Santa Susana High. She's going to Moorpark College. Ryan Driscoll went to Moorpark High School. These are local kids who are going to be playing the leads in this show. And like all the folks who've been given their start at Cabrillo Music Theater, we hope that they will be moving on to a great, great future in the arts. And we have other kids here today, our Cabrillo kids, and whether they choose the arts as their future or just something to love, we are glad for their participation with Cabrillo Music Theater and the role that they've played in our company and the role we've played in their lives. You're going to hear a song tonight from Children of Eden. Children of Eden is loosely based, on the first 10 chapters of Genesis. It uses the stories of Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, and Noah and the flood to tell a story about all parents, all children, all families. It speaks to everyone who sees it. And the music is by Stephen Schwartz, who wrote Wicked and Pippin and Godspell and won an Academy Award for Prince of Egypt. And he considers Children of Eden his favorite of his shows. The song you're about to hear takes place in the second act, the Noah part of the story. Noah's son, Japheth, has fallen in love with a servant girl who bears the mark of Cain. After some struggle, they have reconciled right before the flood and have vowed to stay together no matter what happens. We're joined today by Ben Ginsberg on the piano. Here are Ryan and Natalia with a song from the second act of Children of Eden.
I don't give a damn for the thunder of fathers, come hell or high water, whatever they do. How could I live in a world without you?
I don't know what to do.
Yona, in whatever time we have. For as long as we are living, we can face whatever comes. If we face it now as one, I could make it on my own. Let me know that I don't have to. No one really wants to be alone. In whatever time we have, if at times we are afraid, with so little to believe in, it's all right to feel afraid. I will hold you in my arms. All we know for sure is this: though the world could end tomorrow, you and I will be together in whatever time.
In whatever time we have, for as long as we are living,
we know life
we can
be
face
battlefields.
If we
but
face
we
it now
run,
as one,
and we won't yield, you'll be my fortress, and I will be your shield.
No one really wants to be alone. In whatever time we have, there are times I've been afraid. In a world that's so uncertain, then I feel your hand in mine, and there's courage in my heart.
We could live 100 years,
or the world could end tomorrow, but we know we'll be together. Most of time, and at least we'll be together in whatever time we
each other.
Well done.
Children of Eden runs April 8th through the 17th upstairs at the Thousand Oaks Civic Arts Plaza. Tickets are available at CabrilloMusicTheater.com or at the Civic Arts Plaza box office. We hope that the community that has expressed so much of an outpouring of affection for Cabrillo will turn that affection into action by coming to see two wonderful shows. Children of Eden, the one they don't know. The Little Mermaid, the one they know. Scott, you were the one to tell me last week you've never seen a Cabrillo Music Theater show you didn't enjoy. So I would say at this point, trust us on this. Children of Eden is going to be one that enchants the entire family, and it's going to be something families can talk about together after they see it. I want to thank you for letting us speak here today and to entertain you, and I hope the rest of the evening is as entertaining as what you just saw.
Yeah, that's going to be a tough act to follow there, Lewis. Next up, item number 6, public comments. Ms. Rodriguez, would you announce public comments, please?
This is the time and place for public comments. A speaker card is available for those wishing to address the City Council regarding items on the agenda or on a subject within the city's jurisdiction. All remarks should be addressed to the council as a whole, and all documents for City Council and the official record should be presented to the city clerk prior to speaking. Speakers are requested to state their name and community of residence for record. Under state law, public comment matters may not be considered by the council unless listed on the agenda, but may be referred to the city manager for administrative follow-up. Seven individuals have presented cards, and pursuant to the council standards, speakers are allowed 3 minutes. The yellow light displays when you have 1 minute remaining.
Thank you very much. And our first speaker tonight will be Joe Kyle, followed by Adam Haverstock. Good evening, Mr. Kyle.
Good evening. Hello, council members and staff. My name is Joe Kyle. I'm a lifelong resident of Thousand Oaks. Medical marijuana patients within this city and I have recently formed the Thousand Oaks Medical Marijuana Outreach Facebook and website. We are attempting to engage the public to see what the future of medical cannabis may look like in our great city. We need all parties to get involved: patients, stakeholders, law enforcement, lawmakers, and citizens who may have concerns. We are asking that, at minimum, the city allow deliveries to deliver to patients within our city, but not allow base of operations within our city. This would allow us to gather sales tax from businesses, from business done within our city. However, not allowing a base of operation would inhibit us from viewing any video monitoring that may be happening. Coachella's ordinance requires 24/7 surveillance to a certain degree of quality, which must then be uploaded to a server and have a minimum of 30 days on said server. Placer County recently made a video about the pros and cons of regulation. Banning everything, even personal cultivation, pushes patients to the black market. This strengthens the black market, leaving law enforcement to deal with heightened crime without increased taxes. If you regulate the businesses that want to pay taxes and be legal, you now have a tax revenue to enforce a black market. We are not asking for storefront dispensaries to be allowed up and down Thousand Oaks Boulevard. We love this great city because of the way it is zoned. The city council has kept it this way. We are asking for discrete bases of operations for delivery services be allowed and deliveries allowed within our town. We are also asking that patients be allowed to personally cultivate. We will soon have a survey up on our website www.toaksmmj.com. It will be short and to the point. It will gauge the public's feeling on what would be okay zoning-wise in our great city. Please join the conversation. Depending on how the conversation go, we may hire a polling service. There will be a letter to the editor about our organization in the next Thousand Oaks Acorn. Earlier today, we were at the Ventura County Board of Supervisors meeting focused on holding a public forum for medical cannabis. Chris Stevens said he has recently sat down with all city's managers. I implore the city council to hold a public forum, or at least attend the public forum the Board of Supervisors will be holding. One of the supervisors mentioned to staff that it should be an ordinance that all cities in Ventura County can adopt. Thank you very much for any consideration on this topic, and thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Kyle. Adam Haverstock, followed by Linda Johnston. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, council members. My name is Adam Haverstock, and I am the Director of Government Affairs and Tourism for the Greater Conejo Valley Chamber of Commerce. I have a couple items I'd like to report to you this evening. The first I wanted to mention, tourism. As you know, we have a tourism district that operates in our city. We've recently invested in some polling from Smith Travel Research to gauge the effectiveness of our tourism efforts, and the initial results are very good. We do receive information about the occupancy and room rates year over year compared to 2015, and so far for this year, year to date, we're up 37% in those categories, which is a huge increase. I wish we could take 100% credit for that increase, but you might be aware of a gas leak that happened out in the Porter Ranch community. We have many, many families that are taking up semi-permanent residence in our local hotels, and so that is contributing a lot to that. But we do, I mean, compared to our peer group, we also see that there is some effort. The tourism revenues are growing in a lot of our local cities, so we do believe there is some benefit from our efforts. I also wanted to mention that we are currently running promotions for weddings, because weddings are a huge, huge tourism driver for the Kaneo Valley, and also for the Amgen Tour of California that's going to be returning to Thousand Oaks on May 16th. So we're trying to get the community, the greater Los Angeles region, San Diego, to come up for that. Second, I wanted to mention the Chamber has a new event this year. It's our 40 Under 40 Awards to honor young professionals and rising stars in our community. That's going to be on Thursday, April 28th, 2016 at the Agora Hills Event Center. And we're currently accepting nominations. So if you know anybody who is under 40 years old who lives or works in Kaneo Valley, they do not need to be a Chamber member. You're welcome to nominate that person to be honored at that event. And nominations are accepted on the Chamber website, kanehochamber.org. We'll be accepting nominations until Monday, March 28th, and then at that point our board of directors will select who the winners are going to be, and the event will be, of course, on April 28th. I wanted to mention our principal for a half-day event, which is coming up on Wednesday, April 6th. It's from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. It's a wonderful collaboration with the Kaneo Valley Unified School District, and we're going to have Chamber members touring different local school sites, and then there's a luncheon that will include our superintendent. And anyone who would like to sign up can also get information on the Chamber website for that. Finally, we've had a couple of events recently. I wanted to thank everyone for your attendance. We had our awards gala at Cal Lutheran University, and we also had our Mixpo, which is our Mixer Expo event, last Wednesday, so also at CLU. Plenty of attendees, over 200 at the Mixpo, over close to 400 at the gala. Wonderful turnout. We're glad to have the support of the community. Thank you all for being there. And unless there are any questions, that does conclude my report. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Adam. Linda Johnston, followed by Ted Smith.
Yeah, I'm Linda Johnston. I'm a resident of Newberry Park. Before I get to my comments, I really want to thank each and every one of you for your service. I know it's not all beer and Skittles. It's not all fun sometimes, and there's a lot of behind-the-scenes work that none of us really know, but you know it because you do it, and I really want to thank you for all those efforts, what we see and what we don't see. A community like ours doesn't become so lovely and wonderful to live in by accident. It gets that way by hard work, and I want to acknowledge each one of you for doing that hard work on my behalf. So for my time left, I want to talk about dogs, a big cat, fleas, and taxes. I noticed in the Acorn some weeks ago that the LA County Animal Care and Control were going to send field workers out going door to door to check for unlicensed dogs. Well, it was with a lot of disgust and chagrin that I read that article. I mean, why are they doing this? Why are we paying for it? Is there a problem? The article didn't say so. Are we having an epidemic of loose dogs that requires such drastic measures? And by what authority are they doing that? Do they have police power? Or do they have search warrant power? Are people obliged to answer their questions and open the door? Are these agents representing themselves as having that authority? And what rights does the person have to refuse to answer their questions? Was a cost-benefit analysis done? Or did the bureaucracy just go ahead and thought it was a good idea? Now, I'm not saying that licensing log for animals is a bad idea. What I'm saying is that this project is a bad idea. Isn't part of limited government our right to just be left alone? Now, is this just another example of agency mission creep, assuming powers not designated, and government overreach? Now, several weeks ago, I was here talking about the raising of the sales tax, and I was advising that we all live within our budget. I mean, I know, as you well know, there's no million-dollar line items on the budget. Solving the spending problem consists of finding lots of small savings over a wide range of agencies. You find $100 here, $1,000 here, and pretty soon you start making some savings. And it reminds me of the oft-quoted but misappropriated statement of the late Senator Everett Dickens, who said, "A billion here, a billion there, eventually, pretty soon, you're talking about real money." Well, that also calls to mind an article in an event that happened at the LA Zoo in 1988. A rare, beautiful snow leopard died of exsanguination. Now, it's just a fancy word, meaning he bled to death. Now, he didn't bleed to death from a wound or from surgery. The loss of blood was from flea infestation. And isn't that shocking? That beautiful, majestic animal was brought down by fleas? Now, no one flea took that much money, or no one flea took that much blood, but it was the amount of them that made him die from the lack of blood. No one knew he had fleas, not the animal carers or the zookeepers. His thick, beautiful, protective coat, which was designed to serve and protect him, was actually harmed by hiding the fleas.
I'm going to have to ask you to finish up, Ms. Johnson.
All right. So basically, I want to say that let's stop the insanguination, let's stop the spending, and let's take our, maybe we could start with the LA County Animal Care and Control. Maybe they're not in this municipal district, but they could serve as a model for how to look at numerous cuts, small cuts, over a lot of areas. And thank you for your patience.
Thank you, ma'am. Ted Smith, followed by Billy Martin.
Not Ted the firefighter. Good evening, council members. My name is Ted Smith, and I live in Newbury Park. And I just appreciate you men so very, very much. The godly wisdom that you need to run this place. Tonight, three quick things. Number one, this is our bean patch. We want it to be a godly bean patch. We want to honor the Lord in everything we do. And that's so, so important that we try to make decisions that the Lord would be pleased with, not the decisions that would offend him. That was number one. Number two, as I said in a prior visit, we continue to have the problem of Planned Parenthood or unplanned parenthood. This is such an atrocious thing that must offend God to the nth degree. We've got to figure out, we do not need it in this community. We need to figure out how to get a handle on that. And then number three is to deal with finance. I worked for Chrysler in Canada in Windsor, Ontario for a number of years. And Patrick, I must have some City Hall blood in me because my mother, I figured out the other day, spent the better part of 35 years as a legal secretary for the city solicitor in Windsor. So there's got to be some City Hall blood in there somewhere. But I spent with Chrysler 7 years as a finance and budget analyst. So I know something about finance and something about budgets. Every year in our assembly plant in Windsor, we would put together a budget. We would send it across the river over to Detroit to head office, and it would be scrutinized with all the budgets from all the other plants. And then Lee Iacocca would make the decisions at a time when Chrysler was very close to bankruptcy. And they would send us back and give us, this is the number we want down on the corner. That's the number you got to meet. That's the target. That's where we want to be. And then we would have to back the numbers all the way up until we spread them backwards till everything balanced. Now, in the area of finance, you've got to have targets, you've got to have goals, and you need to control expenses. So to that end, you get requisitions from people who want supplies and people who want staff. People love to build staff. The little empire building, we've got to have a lot of staff. But there comes a time with Chrysler and Ford and others, they look at their white collar workers and they say, this is huge. We've got to cut back. We've just grown way too big. And so you end up having to cut back and lay off. You go back to the departments. Everybody's got to lay off one or two people or whatever. We've got to get this thing back under control. So that's our target around here. We've got to live within our means. We just can't go get extra money. That's not going to work. Next time, I'm going to tell you what happened in Windsor, Ontario, when we did not follow godly ways. Right, but it's too late for me to share today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Billy Martin, followed by Eric Sternad.
Out of the bag. My name is Billy Martin. I'm a Thousand Oaks lover. And Gina and my other giraffe, Jones, will be going on tour with me with the Jungle Land tour. And What I'd like to say about the Jungle Land Tour is it is a private enterprise, but it's also a community service event. We are going to be traveling with artifacts, photos, and art exhibits, and on top of that, there will be a one-man show, and it's going to be the history of Jungleland mixed with music of the 60s. So the whole reason that I'm doing this, and it's been a publicity stunt. I'm kind of sorry about what I did last time, but it's always been about the giraffes. The last four meetings, it's been about the giraffes. So it's about the giraffes, and it's about Jungleland, and giraffes mean fun. And we're going to have a lot of fun with the Jungle Land Tour, so I hope you get to see me out there. But what it is for the city is it's my audition. Next year, I want to do the Copper Topper Tour. And I'm going to apply the same marketing principles in the Copper Topper. And what we do is the main marketing principle in this is I have no advertising budget. It's all done with collaborative marketing. It's also not an event that I'm trying to bring people to. It's an event that I'm going to where the people are. We'll be opening on Arbor Day, April 16th. We'll be at CVD. We'll be at Relay for Life. And we might be having a Jungle Land reunion at the Stagecoach Inn Museum. We'll see how it goes. That's the spring tour. And we'll be back in the fall with an art exhibit right here and a bunch of other things. So at any rate, I'm not going to take up any more of your time. I would like to, the final marketing principle behind this is that it's a limited edition. The tour started on March 1st. These giraffes have been posted above the 23 freeway. I don't know if anybody's seen them when they've come across Sunset Hills Boulevard. And Gina will go back with Jones as I leave here tonight. But I think I had another point. But at any rate, I'll see you all on I'll see you all on tour. It's a limited edition, March to November 10th. 80th birthday of July. 90th birthday.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. And Gina. Eric Sternad, followed by Nick Kidwai.
Good evening, Mayor Price, Council, and City Manager Mitnick. Thank you very much for just a few minutes to talk with you about 211. 211 is a three-digit information and referral line for any resident of the county. And so you should have in front of you a 2015 report and a two-pager that profiles the callers from TO and what they're calling for. So I thought I'd just come tonight and briefly speak to you about it. Happy to come back if you'd like some more extended conversation about it. So in the last year, 1,500 Thousand Oaks residents called 211. 211 is a program at Interface Children and Family Services. It's free to the public. There's also an expanded website capability now where anyone can log on through the Interface website or 211ventura.org. and search all of the available health and human services across the whole county. So in addition to the 1,500 callers, we had about 900 or so on average website searches from folks in this area. As you'll see in the front page, the most of the referrals in terms of directing the public to call 211 are coming from other nonprofits. So they see this as an important resource and a connection point so that we can maximize the services that we're all paying for as taxpayers. And then on the back of that summary page on the City of Thousand Oaks callers, you'll see the top 10 caller needs. And by the way, the public can look at the annual report by going onto the Interface Children and Family Services website. So it's published there, as well as, of course, the resources themselves. But what you'll see from the top 10 caller needs is that Thousand Oaks callers track pretty steadily, match the general county requests, except in the area of housing, where there's a brief, a small increase, couple percent increase over typical callers across the county. So that gives you a sense of what folks are calling 211 for. 211 does have a lot of data that we can leverage to look at where the needs are across communities. The last thing I would say is that you'll see a one-pager that shows a screenshot of our new guided search. Mm-hmm. So there's an intuitive website search that is now available. Again, you can reach that at 211ventura.org. and the public can search for any health and human services that they may need across our community. That would include governmental services as well as nonprofit services for the community. So last but not least, the social service fund recommended, again, funding for 2-on-1. We appreciate your past funding and hope that you're able to approve that. They recommended 3,000 of the 8,000 that was recommended. So hopefully you'll see fit to recommend the continuation of that funding for 2-on-1. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And final speaker, Mr. Kidwai.
I beg in the name of God, who is most beneficial, most merciful. My name is Nick Iqbal Kidwai. I'm resident of Newbury Park, and since 91, Director of Concerned Citizens, Thousand Oaks. First of all, Mayor and Council, I would like to thank you all for your service, including the staff, for bearing with us and taking this job on, including the wonderful new face that we have. Wish her best of luck. I would like to let you know that there's a simple one-page form required with no excuses if you want to extend a project. That's what Lowe's, who's building in Newbury Park, did. I appealed it, and an administrative hearing was held in the Oak Room with a complete TV and all that. But the city wants to push something and not push something, so no TV is allowed. So not only that, if you go to the city's first page, there's 20-plus committees whose agendas are on page one. Even today, I brought it to the attention. I discovered 2 months ago that the administrative hearing is not listed there. Can you believe that? That's where all these cases start, and it's a secret. They don't want you to know. I don't know. Hopefully, it will be changed. There was almost no outreach done for the Lowe's project, which includes two additional fast food restaurants as well as a fitness center. Fitness centers, as you know, they are in trouble. We've already had people go out of business. And the city paid $50,000 in 94 to a consultant, business consultant, who said there will be cannibalism in this market. Cannibalism? That is not people eating people, but businesses eating people. The pie is only so big, so you open another fitness center, the existing fitness centers will not be able to survive and will go out of business. So the Planning Commission, in their wisdom, approved it on a 3-2 vote. I wanted to appeal it. The tax to appeal to City Council is $1,475. But Lowe's appealed this to the City Council. It was supposed to be heard today. Now it's going to be heard on April 12th. But the city attorney, in her wisdom, thinks that you can only speak on the item that has been appealed. So the cannibalism issue is off the table. I have talked to many attorneys out here. They are scared. For what reason? I don't know. To take on the city. So I'm appealing to, if anybody knows an attorney in the San Fernando Valley or Santa Barbara that would like to take this case, I will be willing. I don't want it pro bono. I'm willing to pay up to $1,000. We need to make sure that we work to keep Newbury Park businesses alive and active, especially the small businesses. There's some people on the podium that have talked about it, but talk is cheap. Action is what is required. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kidwai. That concludes the public comments. Mr. Mintdick, do you have any follow-up to the public comments?
No, thank you.
Very well. Then we're on to item number 7, the consent calendar. Any questions of council? No desire to pull anything? Okay. Then I'd be looking for Mr. Fox. Move consent. Thank you. Then if there's no discussion, vote please.
The motion carries 5-0. Ordinance titles, Ordinance repealing Chapter 2, Article 10 of Title 10 of Municipal Code, and thereafter readopting Chapter 2, Article 10 of Title 10 of Municipal Code, relating to updated construction definitions, standards, and use of groundwater wells within city boundaries, and an ordinance amending Thousand Oaks Municipal Code Title 9, Chapter 4, adding or revising definitions and zoning regulations concerning substance abuse treatment facilities, residential care facilities, large, assisted living facilities, boarding houses, lodging houses, and supportive housing, MCA 2015-70320.
Thank you very much. That takes us to item 8A, the public hearing on the Lowe's issue. That has been moved to the April 12th meeting.
Mayor, what about this?
So we are on to
consent calendar.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Mr. Kidwai. You may have the mic.
I don't like to speak from the floor, but unfortunately, sometimes you have to do that. Nick Kidwai, Director, Concerned Citizens, Thousand Oaks, Honorable Mayor, Council. If city staff can show the overhead. I can't see it properly. Too much light, it looks like. That's the minutes that you are approving, and it shows that I spoke on the consent calendar, which consisted of about 26 items. Well, the interesting thing is, WikiLeaks founder contacted me just before I came over here about recording the conversation between Raul and Mr. Obama. He was upset and he said, how dare you badmouth our system of government when you have this pristine, wonderful city? Look at the minutes that they have. I mean, they cannot even get their minutes right. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention, that hopefully the new city clerk will, and this city, I learned the ropes here. They had very good minutes, and they are part of the archive until 10, 15 years ago. What can I say? Well, the city is giving $10,000, number H, to seniors. Well, that's the thing. Peanuts for good programs, millions, almost millions, for staff and for retirement. Thank you for staring at me. I like that. You also have a resolution confirming Oakmont Senior Housing. I think I've run out of steam, so I'll go while the going is well, right? Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you, Mr. Kidwai, and I apologize for missing that.
That's all right.
Okay. Thank you. All right, then we are on to item 9A, which is a potential countywide Ventura County Transportation Commission sales tax ballot measure. And we're going to hear from our Public Works Director, Jay Spurgeon, and Mr. Darren Kettle, who is the Ventura County Transportation Commission Executive Director. Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and Council. And I'm going to go ahead and just turn this over to Darren Kettle, who is the Executive Director of the Ventura County Transportation Commission, to give you a briefing on the proposed transportation countywide sales tax measure.
Thank you, Jay, and good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the City Council. Again, my name is Darren Kettle. I'm the Executive Director of the Ventura County Transportation Commission. Most of you certainly understand and are aware of who the commission is. Just by way of quick background, the Ventura County Transportation Commission was formed by state law in 1988, it consists currently of 17 commissioners, including 15 local elected officials. All 10 cities are represented on the commission, including the city of Thousand Oaks, and you are ably represented by council member, actually Mayor Pro Tem, I will call her commissioner, Claudia Bill de la Pena. We have all five county supervisors and two citizen appointees. The commission has asked me to, and I appreciate time on your agenda, Mr. Mayor, to present to all councils in Ventura County to talk a little bit about the challenges we're going to be struggling with when it comes to transportation, lay out some of the issues that we're going to be wrestling with, one of the possible solutions, and then do what I can to respond to questions. So starting right off, this cranky looking guy is the former Secretary of Transportation. His name's Ray LaHood. He was actually in the Obama administration. He's a Republican out of Illinois. And he's now, again, the former Secretary of Transportation, so we can really call him like he sees him. And so at this point, this number is the $3 billion shortfall is a bit shy, actually. In the course of the last couple of years, that number has grown. But Secretary LaHood calls it, as he sees him, like I said, America is one big pothole right now. So this is a discussion about the nature of our crumbling infrastructure all over the country, but certainly in Ventura County, we have our challenges right here in our backyard. So we go from a cranky-looking guy to someone that's a little bit more pleasant in how she presents to Ventura County, and certainly someone in our own backyard. And it's about issues related to traffic, particularly on the 101 corridor, but not just on the 101 corridor, but also the 118 freeway corridor between Simi Valley and Moore Park. I won't read the quote from the president and CEO of the Conejo Valley Chamber. It speaks for itself. This was in the Thousand Acres Acorn back in January. But congestion is growing in Ventura County, and over the course of the next 15 to 20 years, it is expected, based on our even modest growth in Ventura County, that congestion on the 101 will increase by 50%. So in round numbers, let's just say during our peak commute period, we're in traffic in bumper-to-bumper gridlock for 2 hours. You do the quick math. In 10 or 15 years, we're sitting in gridlock for 3 hours during the PM peak. Same situation in the AM peak. So we know we're going to have to deal with growing congestion on the 101 and also on the 118 corridor. Currently today, we spend 28,000 hours in daily traffic. When you start adding it all up, that is the amount of time that Ventura County commuters spend sitting in delayed traffic. The third issue that's out there after infrastructure crumbling and congestion is the fact that our population is aging. And while it's growing at modest levels, the area that it's growing fastest is our aging population, our seniors. Or actually, I should say, our baby boomers are becoming seniors. And with that, we are going to struggle with how do we make sure the most mobile generation that we have ever seen in our country stays mobile. We talk about the fact that this baby boomer generation has enjoyed that mobility, and I'm going to be willing to bet they're not going to sit idly by sitting in their homes. I use a term, latchkey seniors. That is probably not something we can expect out of the baby boomer generation, and we're not prepared to move that population at this point. The next issue is dealing with a significant reduction in both state and federal funds. The graph on your left, what that generally explains currently is that the Federal Highway Trust Fund simply isn't raising enough money to keep up with our transportation investments that our country's calling for. Starting in 2008, the Federal Highway Trust Fund has had to deal with effectively a subsidy, an augmentation from the general fund, the U.S. Treasury. Our country has normally funded, has historically funded transportation from the federal, from the gas tax. And we have, in Ventura County, for a variety of reasons, have struggled to compete for bringing gas tax dollars back to Ventura County. But starting in 2008, it wasn't just gas tax. It's now also our income tax. The federal government is now supporting the Federal Highway Trust Fund. And it's being done out of the U.S. Treasury, not just out of gas taxes. That's the graph on the left. The picture on the right is just an LA Times story talking about the fact that about a month or so ago, the California Transportation Commission, which is the agency that funds commissions like the Ventura County Transportation Commission, took $0.75 billion out of the state highway improvement program. Now, the reason for that is, as a consumer, it's great to have lower gas prices. And we have enjoyed that in the last few years in California. What it impacts, though, is that same revenue stream is what has funded the state contribution of our transportation system. Had we been in this situation in Ventura County where we actually had projects on the list, and this is part of the second part of the somewhat sad story that I have to present to you, is it's very possible we would have had projects removed from the list. This council, your city council, has supported the commission and transportation in this county by loaning a project funding. Unprecedented, really, when it comes to a local agency stepping up the way the city of Thousand Oaks did, to loan funding to a state transportation improvement project, the 101-23 freeway interchange. It's underway right now. That project got started 3 years in advance of what it would have normally been under our normal state transportation funding mechanisms. It is altogether possible that given the loss of funding we are seeing in California right now, that project, not certainly, but could have been on the chopping block had the city and VCTC not come together to develop the program we did. But in so doing, we've also mortgaged our future. That 101-23 freeway interchange project that's currently under construction is the last project we have on the drawing board. And absent new significant sources of funding, you will see no new construction on either the 101 or the 118 corridors for the foreseeable future. So obviously, if you get a chance to use Beetle Bailey in a slide, and it's relevant, it's kind of nice to be able to do that. So we do have a fiscal cliff, and we have a bumpy road. It smooths out when you go off the cliff, but when you land, it's a little bit harsh. And we don't have any easy Band-Aid fixes. So the commission has asked me as their executive director to work with a special committee of the commission, an eight-member committee, on which, of course, my commissioner, Claudia Bill De La Pena, sits, one of eight representatives on the commission, sitting on an ad hoc committee to develop a potential transportation revenue measure for funding transportation investments in Ventura County. It's an eight-member committee, including council member Bill De La Pena, but it also includes three supervisors, including Supervisors Foy, Long, and Bennett. And then we have four other local elected officials, including on the east portion of the county, council member Keith Milhouse from the city of Moore Park. In general, a half-cent sales tax measure raises $70 million for transportation investments that has to stay in Ventura County. It can't go to Sacramento and Washington. We asked Cal Lutheran University's Center for Economic Research and Forecasting to do a cost estimate of what it would cost each individual of Ventura County. The cost estimate they came up with, after you back out tourism dollars and business-to-business sales, is about $1 per week per resident. If you want to look at sort of the average family of 3.2 people, it's less than a gallon of gas per family per week to set aside $70 million for a variety of transportation programs. And so the next slide is the concept, the potential funding distribution that the commission has put out as a concept. And this is anything but etched in stone. It was put together to develop as an outreach program, but also get feedback. I call it somewhat of a meat and potatoes program, with a lot of investment in local streets and roads and freeways and highway programs. We have received, as you might expect when you start talking about this kind of funding stream, a lot of questions and comments. If you were looking at percentages, the local street and road percentage is about 40% of the revenues. Freeways and highways are about 20%. We've had a variety of comments, including the city management group that is talking about wanting to see 50% to local streets and roads. And I will get into my presentation that will sort of play that out a little bit more as we get to the local level. And you can see the other programs that are there, and I'll touch on them here shortly. I'm going to touch on a couple of the big freeway projects first. Obviously, I think the 101 corridor is recognized as Ventura County's Main Street. It's our economic backbone. That project that has been proposed and is very early in the planning stages is improving the 101, adding a lane in each direction from the Los Angeles County line to the 33, which is the route up to Ojai. It's about 28 miles of freeway improvements. It's about an $800 million project to add a lane in each direction through urban Ventura County. It also includes freeway interchange improvements at all locations that would be necessary to ensure the improvements could be made on the mainline freeway corridor, and that's where you see the stars on the map. So that's a substantial project, and it has been something that, as we've done our voter research and our community outreach, is one of those projects that everybody rallies around and sees the value in. The other project is a continuation of the four-lane stretch of the 118 in Simi Valley, where it goes from four lanes down to three lanes down to two lanes from Topo Canyon in Simi Valley to the bridge at the Arroyo Simi in Moor Park. In our world, it's a relatively affordable. It's a bargain basement project at $150 million and still a staggering sum of money, but it's $150 million to add what would be two lanes in each direction from the, one lane in each direction from Topo Canyon to Madera, so you have four lanes. And you generally run those four lanes all the way up to about Princeton. And those, then at Princeton, just before you go over the bridge, it would drop to three lanes. And then we would have three lanes over the bridge at the Arroyo, over the Arroyo Simi Bridge, matching up with the existing 23 freeway. Again, about $150 million. And that's assuming if some improvements have to be done to the Arroyo Simi Bridge. Some of the studies we've done, we can fit three lanes on the existing bridge over the Arroyo Simi. We do not necessarily need to do added construction unless we wanted to have bigger shoulders on the edges. So it is a project that may be able to be done less than at $150 million. Another key program is the Regional Road Freight Movement Package, recognizing the economic engine that is the Port of Hueneme as well as our military bases. The picture on the bottom left of the screen is the proposal for a new bridge over the railroad crossing at Rice Avenue. We're just about 1 year past past the anniversary of where the truck pulled onto the tracks at Rice Avenue and got stuck. Metrolink train derailed, and the train engineer lost his life about a week after due to his injuries. This project is about a $45 million project to build a bridge and reconnect what is Rice Avenue and connecting Rice Avenue ultimately to the Port of Hueneme. That's the blue hash mark on the screen is from 101 down to Hueneme Road and then Hueneme Road into the port. So we have a freight movement component and a continuation of that on the northerly side of 101, which connects to the 126 and ultimately to Interstate 5. The idea being do what we can to move freight in and out of Ventura County as quickly as possible. But one of the things to remember is that one of the ways we were able to fund the 101 23 interchange was with freight movement money. And we do have new federal law that is funding freight movement, which is a good sign for us. So I could see this funding also going to improvements on the 101 corridor. I'm going to touch briefly on transit. First, on the buses side, on public transit side, we have seen that our voters are concerned about making sure fares stay at reasonable levels for seniors, the veterans, the disabled, and students. That's a particular issue. Our transit operators say they would like to see more service. It doesn't have to be a large program. Ventura County is fairly well funded when it comes to transit funds, but there are still programs that we could augment it. The bigger issue, I think, is as we wrestle with rail, and for those of you that aren't aware, the Ventura County Transportation Commission is the agency that makes sure Metrolink gets its money from Ventura County so that it continue to operate. And of course, there are five Metrolink stations in Ventura County. The way we've been able to stay in the system is we have an arrangement with Los Angeles County Metropolitan Transportation Authority. We get a lot of federal capital funds, and we exchange that with LA County Metro for their operating funds. It's been an arrangement we've had for two decades. LA County Metro has said we can no longer continue that operation. We can't continue that arrangement. We're going to have to keep those operations funds for ourselves. That translates to $6.8 million that we have of federal funds that we now cannot exchange for operating funds with LA County Metro. That money is going to have to come from someplace. And the only other place we have is coming from our programs that generally support our bus systems. So we have a real issue as it relates to how we will prioritize, and Commissioner Bill De La Pena may very well have to wrestle with that question during her time on the commission if no new sources of funds are identified. So I'm going to talk really quickly about city streets, and this number is going to be a little out of date from the City of Thousand Oaks because I just saw an article in the Ventura County Star about 2 or 3 weeks ago, maybe a month ago, where your public works staff let you know that you have a $5 million at least shortfall this coming year. So if we project that out over 30 years, we do the math, and we're talking about somewhere on the order of $150 million in lost funding or lost revenues to meet your local street and road needs. So that's a round number. So again, this is based on the commission's first sort of rollout of a 40% local street and road measure program. But again, this is something that is continues to be up for discussion. And I can tell you that the city managers and the county chief executive officer have been wrestling with how much that local return could very well be, and then the formulas that might turn that money back to you. Under the 40% concept, the revenues back to the city of Thousand Oaks were in the $4 to $4.5 million range. If you get to a 50% number, you're talking somewhere between $5.5 to $6 million when you start looking at the total revenue stream. Money for active transportation, bike trails, pedestrian projects. We have a community that we have avid cyclists, we have commuters that are cyclists, and as well as pedestrians that are commuters. And so this does not have to be a large program. It needs to be a support program. There have become new federal funds available for bicycle and pedestrian types of projects, active transportation. Where we have had trouble competing is that we've not brought the local match. We have local jurisdictions that do not have the revenue streams throughout Ventura County to be able to compete with our neighbors to the north and the south who have local, that do have local revenue streams to help provide that local match. The nature of any transportation program anymore has to have an environmental component for it to be successful. We've talked about everything from dealing with stormwater runoff off of city streets to habitat, buying habitat for, when we start talking about acquiring property for roadway improvements, oftentimes there are environmental mitigation requirements, including habitat. A program has been developed where anywhere from the concept that the commission is at least, again, has out for conceptual reasons and conceptual purposes is 7.5% of the revenues would go to that. That raises somewhere on the order of $240, $250 million over 30 years to support environmental programs, including water runoff, habitat acquisition, and also air quality issues. So this political, you know, obviously if you make it into a political cartoon, your issue should resonate a little bit. I won't go into the details here. I think it speaks for itself that for all of these different reasons, if we were to have a conversation about a half cent sales tax and a dollar per week in the grand scheme of things, what does that buy us in the for the purposes of our quality of life? Reducing the amount of time we spend on the freeway. This is a Los Angeles Times story a columnist wrote that targeted Ventura County, asking the question, what is going on in Ventura County when it comes to investing in transportation? Yogi Berra calls it like he sees it, and we are at a bit of a fork in the road. We have to wrestle with this question. If you're at the fork, you take it. We do have choices, and the commission is exploring this idea of how we move forward, and should the county move forward with the half-cent sales tax measure for transportation investments, money that stays here in Ventura County, does all the things that I've mentioned it could do, and or not, and that is an option as well. We don't look at that, and we see all of the those other consequences that we may realize if those local dollars don't come to pass. The commission, you should have received in the mail, hopefully in the last few days, a mailer that came out that sort of goes into greater detail with this program and this plan. We have our website, keepvcmoving.org, that hopefully will we have been receiving a tremendous response from, as you might expect when you start asking people about these types of questions, and we have gotten all sorts of feedback, positive and less than positive. And we're going to continue to receive that that type of feedback over the course of the next few weeks. The commission is going to be in the field with a voter survey over the course of the next couple weeks, and Commissioner Bill De La Pena will be sitting in one of our ad hoc committee discussions in early April to talk about where those results are from the poll and what our next steps would be. So, Mr. Mayor, with that, I thank you again for your time, and I'm happy to answer questions on the part of the council.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kell. Questions of council? Mr. Fox first.
Thanks, Mr. Mayor. Darren, good evening.
Good evening.
Thanks for coming out.
My pleasure.
Appreciate the presentation. Just a few questions. Is this the first of maybe another presentation? Okay. Asking cities, because I understand you're kind of on tour going to all the cities in the county with a similar presentation.
That's correct. This is the education and outreach component. If the commission chooses to proceed, I would be back before you requesting a resolution for it to be placed on the ballot to the Board of Supervisors, who ultimately makes that final decision to place it on the ballot.
So you're at some point in time, assuming you move forward, which is still in question, you're going to be asking for a formal declaration or resolution from each city on their support or non-support for any kind of sales tax increase.
The request would be to authorize it to go to the ballot. So we have to do that first, even before you would choose to support it. So there's a potentially a third step that if you wanted the council wanted to take such specific action of supporting the measure itself.
All right. Now, not every city has a representative on the commission. Is that correct?
All 10 cities do.
Oh, they do?
Yes.
That's right. Okay. Specific to how it's apportioned right now, and I recognize, in fairness, you said that it's up for discussion. This is just kind of a number. You have to start somewhere. The Public Works Department, a couple of months ago, when we went through our street maintenance kind of discussion, presented to the council that we're going to have actually a $6.5 million annual requirement to meet our streets and roads. And if I heard you right, at the 40% mark, that would provide around $4.5 million to the city. Is that correct?
That based on the various formulas, Councilmember Fox, that's a round number that's been sort of it's a ballpark.
Okay.
Yes.
And the 50% is somewhere in the six and a half.
Five and a half to six, I think, were the numbers that I've seen.
Okay. Yeah. We haven't polled the council, and I can guarantee you that at least here, I'm going to suggest to the council that we take a formal position on this. I recognize Ms. Bilodeau-Pena is our representative, but the council, from my perspective, is going to make a decision on whether this city is going to be in support of a sales tax measure, not necessarily representatives on the commission. That's my view anyway. But I will say that speaking from my own perspective, the minimum amount that the city should get should be 50%. And I would even go far as to say that from my perspective, streets, roads, infrastructure, city infrastructure, it should be the top priority. Because the vast amount of money is going to be coming from cities. And these folks up here, I think 50% of their dollar, of every dollar to go for countywide issues, could be argued, but we recognize we're part of a larger, system, and it can't be all coming back to Thousand Oaks. But from my perspective, a minimum amount would be 50% of the taxpayer money from Thousand Oaks would be generated here would at least come back to the city. And really, the reason for that is very simple. There's really no reason for the city to support this unless it meets the city's needs, because we have a deficit too. And I don't imagine that we're going to have another sales tax or transportation come anytime soon. So if it doesn't meet the city's needs at 50%, I don't know why we would support that. That's more of a statement than a question. Mm-hmm. But I would just put that out, because I know you're going to be going back to the commission. Claudia's right here, so she's hearing, at least from one perspective. But moving forward, I think sooner rather than later, who's ever putting these numbers together needs to take a real hard look at a 50% share for the cities. And I would imagine other cities in the county are looking at the same thing. And for here in Thousand Oaks, we do have a deficit, and that 50% puts us just at where we need to be. The other question I have has anybody done any survey on some of these other countywide issues in terms of the percent of city populations that uses these services? For example, do we know the percent of Thousand Oaks residents that use the Metro Rail, the link, the train?
MetroLink has done some surveys, Councilmember Fox, in the past about where ridership is based. I don't have that handy, but it's data that's available. It may be a little dated, but it would be good enough for the purposes of analytical reasons.
Okay, that's good. Mm-hmm. I don't know the number to that. My sense is it's fairly low, because you got to get in the car, you got to drive to Moore Park, get out of your car, then get in the train. But I also know that people do use it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think that might be helpful information for cities, mm-hmm, as they look at this cost apportionment with respect to what kind of value that provides for our residents, for the folks that we represent. Because again, I'm going to emphasize, I've been around a long time. I get it. This can't be just an isolationist type thing. What's in it for the city? At the same time, I think the residents expect us to be good, strong negotiators on their behalf and make sure that if they're going to be asked for a half-cent sales tax for the next 30 years, that they get their fair share back. And we all know Thousand Oaks, Oxnard, it's a pretty large sales tax generator. The other question I have is any discussion on, in terms of site of where the tax actually comes from, in terms of where that comes back?
The managers have been talking about various formulas that include a generation component, sales tax generation component. I'd say it's in play for the purposes of the managers having that conversation.
Okay, and again, I'm going to, you're probably used to hearing this, kind of the same thing. It seems to be just common sense fairness that if it's raised in Thousand Oaks, then, you know, at least 50% has got to come back to Thousand Oaks. That's, you know, my view. It just seems real basic to me. Anything other than that, you know, I think for me anyway, you know, I'm going to want to have some more discussion. And then just since we're on this topic, Mr. Mitnick, I don't know if you were planning on it, but as this thing moves forward, I would like updates from the Transportation Commission or from Claudia, if she comes back as our representative, to let us know as this thing moves forward so the city can take a formal position on this. I want to be clear on that. It's a lot of money. It's a big time issue. This council, and I would suggest every council in the city, in the county rather, should formally take a position on this, for or against. But I'd like to make sure that we have that brought back to us. That's all I got.
Yeah, Mr. McCoy.
Darren, thank you for your presentation.
Sure, my pleasure.
My concern, California has the highest gas tax, sales tax, income tax, corporate tax. We lead the nation in taxes. We have the highest debt in the nation, and we're asking for more taxes upon the backs of our citizens. And I know this is the educational component of your presentation, but nowhere in here do I see anything that's being cut or any expression of the county looking to cut anything. And we've heard from countless citizens that they have to trim their budget in these trying times. And I don't see that in this presentation. I see the Yogi Berra comment that when you come to a fork in the road, take it. I would say when you come to a fork in the road, put the fork down and get rid of the pork consumption. Mm-hmm. I'm concerned that there isn't any effort by the county to reduce its consumption. I want to know what the rider share is for Metrolink. I think it's a big money waster. I think we lose a lot of money on that. And you're asking our citizens another $29 a year, and to you or to the county, it doesn't seem like a lot, but when you're inundated, our energy costs in California are 48% higher than Colorado, and that's the next highest in the nation. And we have everybody leaving our county to go work because they can't afford the taxes and there's no employment. So I would say let's induce businesses and have them come as opposed to scaring them out by increasing taxes. It's ranked the 50th in the nation for doing business. That was an LA Times article. So I want to see where the cuts are going to come. This is something that we as a county need to examine before the cities are going to embrace this. I'd like to see that in the educational component. And so just for that understanding, please include that, if you would, and take a look at those things. Because to put another burden on the back of our citizens without looking at us as a government that's ever increasingly getting larger and the debt's increasing, you can't tax us enough that you still continue to do deficits. So this has to be looked at, and I would like to see that part of a component on this, please.
Ms. Bill De La Pena.
Thank you. I would like to respond to Councilmember Fox regarding the ad hoc committee on which I represent the City of Thousand Oaks, as Mr. Kettle has mentioned numerous times. The ad hoc committee has a wide range of differing views. So, and I also would like to stress that it is yet not a given whether this will make it to the ballot. But once the commission, the Ventura County Transportation Commission, makes a decision, after that, should it make it to the ballot, then the city will get to chime in. In fact, we will be asked not only to put it on the ballot, but then also, as we have done in the past, whether to support it, whether to oppose it, or stay neutral. In reference to how the distribution would go, that has not been finalized at all. The 50% that you mentioned is 50% that would go to all the cities for local roads and streets. Now, the percentage of Thousand Oaks, the sales tax, you talked about return to source, would be approximately 17-18%. So of that 50% that would be allocated to roads and streets, if we were indeed to go to return of source or some sort of similar formula, we would have about 17%, and that would make up approximately $6 million per year. But again, this is still premature. I do see how Ventura County misses out on matching grants, for example. Also, with a measure such as this, only 1% of the money can go to administrative services and salaries and all those things. Only 1% under California state law. It would be illegal to allocate more than 1% to administrative costs. So the City of Thousand Oaks will have ample time to further discuss this and to eventually take a position on this. And I will be more than happy to come to the council with updates to inform you as to how we're doing as the ad hoc committee, as well as the Ventura County Transportation Commission at large regarding this particular item.
Thank you. Thanks for that correction, because I was talking 50% per for the cities. Mm-hmm. I don't imagine we're going to get 50% of all the sales tax. Although I think the city manager would probably be pretty happy with that.
Mr. Adam?
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. Just a couple of questions and then a comment. A lot of percentages have been thrown around here, but from what I gather, of the $70 million a year, roughly 60% would be tagged for regional projects, and about 40% would go to the cities, which would amount to somewhere around $28 million a year.
Under this concept, it's actually would be, Councilmember Adams, it would be higher than that, because there's a couple of pots that would only go back to local governments, but it would be done through competitive, like the environmental component. That would be something that the City of Thousand Oaks, an example, would ask for funding for related to environmental concerns. So, it would be higher than that. But
okay, well, higher or lower doesn't remember. What I'm getting at, it conceptually, there's 10 cities, Thousand Oaks and Oxnard. Trade Places is the highest sales tax producing cities. Is this ultimately going to be split proportionately or equally?
The 40% is, again, that's the formula that's still under conversation about how it would be distributed. But the idea is to develop some formula that would be believed to be as equitable as you can with 10 local jurisdictions at the table, recognizing population as an example, lane miles, possibly tax generation, and coming up with a formula that there's a consensus around.
All right, so the commission's well aware of this then, and they're wrestling with the outcome and conceptually. I mean, obviously, as a Thousand Oaks City Council member, the proportionate concept sounds a little better than me than the equal one, but we'll see what you guys come up with. The other thing is this: gas tax dollars are way down. That's been one of our problems. But there's a movement afoot, and they're down because of all these fuel-efficient cars that we're using less gas. But there's a movement afoot to charge for your vehicles as the miles that they travel, vehicle miles traveled. So instead of paying tax on gas, you pay tax on how many miles you travel, which some consider to be more equitable way to raise tax dollars. And as I understand, the state of California is testing this with 5,000 cars right now. Where does VCTC stand on this? And if this movement were to take foot, would that obviate, you know, the need for something like the sales tax?
Well, I think fundamentally our country has to change how it raises revenues for transportation, because the gas tax is going the way of the Edsel. And so we're at a point where the idea that's coming out of the vehicle miles traveled charge is effectively going to be a net zero change. It's going to be a matter of the lost gas taxes are made up from the vehicle miles traveled. I think that there's a reason that there are 20 other counties in California that have passed sales tax measures to invest locally in transportation, including Los Angeles County, which has a penny and a half, and Santa Barbara, which has a half cent. So those already exist. I think it's a recognition that there is a expectation now at the state and federal level, because the world's a very different place than it was even 10 years ago, where the rules of the game are you better bring some local money to the table if you want to compete for projects and for funding. And that is a significant change from where we were a decade ago.
So you're thinking the vehicle miles traveled approach would be a zero-sum game versus the gas tax that we're using now?
Yeah, I think the term that continues to be used is revenue neutral.
All right, revenue neutral. Okay. And then a comment, maybe you could comment back. I'm quite surprised to see, I got the brochure at home, like everybody else, quite surprised to see that there's no recognition of the biggest transportation revolution that we're going through right now in our generation, and that's ride sharing. Mm-hmm. Ride sharing could reshape transportation in Southern California as well, and it's already doing that across the whole nation. And I can give you some examples. The obvious ones, Uber and Lyft, mm-hmm. of course. But there's cities now that are actually contracting with these ride-sharing companies. There's one in Florida, Adelanto Springs, has contracted with Uber to do the first mile, last mile gap that you've probably heard of. You know, when people want to get to a public transportation system, a lot of times they got to get that first mile there to get to it, and then when they get let off, they got to get the first mile back or the last mile back home again. Adelanto Springs is subsidizing Uber to provide that service. There's other examples. Boston, San Francisco are using Bridge, which is they bill it as this is not your grandmother's bus service anymore. These are tailored bus lines, very efficient, very cost effective, $5 a ridership, 15 people on a van. Because what's happening, as I get it, with public transportation, government can't compete with this kind of effort. We are losing ridership. Our ridership's declining on our buses. Our ridership's declining in the metro. Our ridership's declining on the metro lines in Los Angeles. And we need to really look at this whole possible public-private partnership with ride sharing to leverage what we're doing and make ourselves more efficient and maybe not have to spend the kind of money that we've been spending on these very expensive highway projects, these very expensive bus lines, to only find that they're underutilized and not particularly well-liked. We can widen freeways. We widened the 23 freeway. It was great, except it's backing up again. And you know, it's almost like if you widen it, they're going to come, and when do you stop? I mean, and I'm not saying that the freeways don't need widening. You know, we obviously between here and Ventura, the traffic's getting pretty terrible. But I really think we need to be a little more farsighted and look at this whole ride-sharing concept because it is efficient, it is environmentally sound, it can take congestion off the roads, and I think VCTC has to really take a close look at this. I'm on the VCOG, Ventura Council of Governments. We had a presentation from Uber and Lyft. It's amazing what they're starting to do with cities now and how it takes the pressure off public transportation and the millions and millions of dollars that we spend and that can be substituted for something that's so much cheaper and just as effective, if not more.
It's a great comment. I think you are correct in that our future, it does potentially lie very much in the Ubers and the Lyfts. I mean, they're going to have potentially their challenges legally as it relates to some of their employees, and there's some other questions about their sustainability. But it is absolutely a very clear option for our future, and we've met with Uber and have actually started trying to figure out how do we look at the suburban model. Councilmember Adams, The locations that you cited are oftentimes very urban, more often than not, very urban settings, and we pride ourselves on our suburban nature here in Ventura County, and having that model work here is going to take a little bit of time for it to mature, but it's doable. I will go so far as to say that in ride sharing, it's the second most frequent or most popular way people commute to work in Ventura County. About 14% of our commuters do carpool, do ride share, and this is all being done in a county that does not have so much as, you know, not even 1 meter of a carpool lane. Actually, there's a little bit in Simi Valley just as you're coming over the grade. Mm-hmm. So there are opportunities that our transportation system can have to benefit express bus, HOV, carpooling, and those types of programs that you just referenced.
And if we can leverage these enterprises, perhaps we can repurpose some of the funds that we're dumping into public transportation now into where I think it's more needed, which may be roads and surface streets and things like that. Thank you, Darren, for coming.
My pleasure.
Ms. Bildea-Pena.
I just wanted to make a quick comment regarding Councilmember Adam mentioning Uber and Lyft. Councilmember Adam and I recently attended the Youth Leadership Summit at the Thousand Oaks Library, and what we heard from middle schoolers as well as high schoolers, because of our lack of public transportation or because our public transportation doesn't go necessarily where these children or students want to go at a particular time of day, they all have Uber passes. They call Uber from the high school, from wherever they are, and they go during their recess break or lunch break and take Uber everywhere they go. And that is really, it is replacing our public transportation system to some extent.
Okay, thank you. I think the tone of the comments from my colleagues up here is very similar to what I would say, so I'm not gonna reiterate everything that you've heard already, except 50% is a good number. Having just been back in Washington, D.C. and met with our Congresswoman Julia Brownlee, that was one of the discussions that we had back there, was that we were leaving, Ventura County is leaving money on the table. The reason being that we don't have our own, we're not a self-help county. And I recognize that. I know that something needs to be done in order to fix that problem, or we're not going to be competitive for those federal dollars and even some state matching grants. So I hope that you've heard our comments loud and clear, and I know that there are a number of ideas floating around amongst the city managers group, and I think that at the end of the day, you know, they will have something that they will collectively agree on that might get you a little bit closer to having the support of the cities, or at least the support of the cities as far as letting the residents decide whether or not they want to tax themselves. So I don't really have any questions for you, but I will now kick it over to Mr. Mitnick, who is chomping at the bit here.
If I could, Mr. Mayor, I think the most important thing is that my commissioner, who's in the room, is the one that's hearing it, because this is their plan. You know, my job is to come out and share this message. Ultimately, it's their plan.
Understood. Here.
Thank you.
Mr. Mitnick?
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, excellent discussion. And you heard reference made to the city managers group. So all 10 city managers and the county CEO have had a number of meetings, most recently last week, and the summary notes have been provided to the council. So the group did unanimously reach consensus that a 50% minimum threshold for local streets and roads is the desired outcome for that. And then how that gets divvied up, that's still being worked on. You heard some questions about and statements about if it should be based on point of sale. That would be our preference. But we're looking at compromise, so we're looking at a blended approach. So different variables are being taken into consideration, such as population, road miles, lane miles, or point of sale. And there are pros and cons to each of those, but we're looking at possibly a blended rate. So the group is working very, very well together. It's nice to have such collaboration. And the county CEO is the current chair of the city managers group, and so we're all working well. So what you see in front of you, that's the consensus of the group. I do want to just point out, now that we're at the end here, and thank Darren Kettle, the executive director. Darren has demonstrated a lot of leadership over the years on countywide transportation issues, and Darren, it's been a pleasure to work with you over this time frame. Darren does a good job keeping us in check in terms of reminding us that there's a bigger picture beyond our city boundaries, and we appreciate that, a real good colleague, good partner with us. But he also does understand the challenges of local streets and roads. That is the biggest issue that we face, not just in Thousand Oaks, but in all 10 cities and the unincorporated area. So we appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Mr. Mayor, just...
Yes, Mr. Fox.
Thank you. Thanks for your indulgence. Yeah, you know, Mr. McMahon brought up a point, and I just, again, because we made some general comments, but this point of sale issue, I don't want it to go away too easily, because Mr. Kettle does do a great job. We have great respect for him, and we all recognize that, you know, transportation is a reasonable issue. That said, the likelihood of this passing, based on what I'm hearing, is a tough one for a lot of the reasons Mr. McCoy talked about. But the reason the point of sale is important is because I'm pretty sure that if Thousand Oaks doesn't support this, it has virtually no chance of passing. I mean, zero, from my perspective. So, you know, our job, recognizing that, is to fight for these folks. We have local roads issues. They're serious issues. If this thing is going to pass, if it should pass, we need to make sure that at least addresses the minimum requirements here in Thousand Oaks. And so relative to the point of sale, when it goes back and has that conversation, I want this on the record. It's not just a passing, we wish we could have it. From my perspective, Thousand Oaks plays a key role, as do other cities. But if we choose not to support this, that is zero measure of chance of passing in my political view. And so that needs to be weighed in, which, you know, half of nothing is nothing. So that's just my review on it.
Okay, if there are no other comments from the council, we will go to speakers. We have two speakers, Mr. Nick Kidwai, followed by Chase Rashid.
Nick Kidwai, resident of Newberry Park, director of Concerned Citizens Thousand Oaks, and somebody who has driven 2.5 miles in Southern California and the rest of the state also in the last 43 years. It was interesting. I like that lady talked about earlier about exceeding the boundaries and living within our budget, and also that these agencies are getting beyond their mandates. Something to think about. I was disappointed in the director saying that the chamber president is a little bit more pleasant. I would say she's very pleasant, and I've known her since she came as a young gal, graduate from the South. But I sympathize with him because he was, I believe, mistreated by the staff, as the citizens are, because in the staff report it just says executive director. You don't have the courtesy to give his name. In fact, I forgot the name, so I Googled before. I have it on my blog, and came up with a story that I had found that he got a 14.5% increase on October 6th, Ventura County Star last year. Mm. He started out at $205,000 and has gone to about $240,000. The retired ex-director, she's very attractive too, I like her. Ginger makes $243,000 for life every year, and may she live another 20 or 30 years. So if we take the two top executives and the one retired, we are spending $1 million just for this. And what are we getting? What kind of jobs are these? And I've talked with the people. This is a glorified administrator's job. It's not a tough job like Al Adam has, in a way, to get, generate business. How many people at Amgen earn 240-plus platinum benefits? Not even 1%, 0.01%, top 10, 15, 20%. And what do you have? They might be out the front door tomorrow. The company may close. There's no risk here. So I was really thrilled to see McCoy come out from hiding and talk the good talk about cutting back. The taxpayers are just fed up. And I'm glad that the director was talking about we need a fundamental change in the way gas taxes. We need a fundamental change in the way government is taking away our tax dollars and being so top-heavy. Especially with the computers and in this day and age, it's very easy job. It doesn't require, I mean, $100,000 would be more than enough. And so you are basically killing the goose that lays the golden egg. And talking about Uber and Lyft, I've been with them since they started, and I'm almost out because it's a very problem. One word: insurance. Get into them. They don't. I mean, do your homework.
Thank you, Mr. Kidwai. Chase Rashid. Good evening, sir.
Oh, thank you. Chase Rashid, City of Thousand Oaks. As a member of the Citizens Transportation Advisory Committee, as an alternate, I was at the meeting where that presentation was presented, so I had seen a lot of that stuff before this meeting. I had a lot of time to think about it, and since I was appointed as an alternate there, I've been getting a lot of feedback from people about public transportation. They want it to be more effective. Now, if we want to talk about the money aspect of it, I think it being more effective would handle that. It would cut costs a lot, because here in the city of Thousand Oaks, we have a couple of routes that are very long, and they aren't that necessarily effective in getting people where they need to go. Some people actually choose to walk rather than ride the bus because the routes are really sort of ineffective. We are improving our transportation system since the governor required that TDA funds be spent on public transportation, and the leftovers couldn't go to roads. And roads are important, but public transportation is important as well. We have people who work in other cities in the county, and they have trouble getting to work sometimes because the public transportation does not work well enough. And if we think about the environment, less cars on the road is good for our environment, and less cars on the road is good for reducing gridlock. When you look at the 101, you see all this gridlock. It's not quite as bad as the 405. But if we could actually get more people into doing park and ride, we could possibly reduce some of the gridlock on the freeways, because our bus service does run between business hours. And as for the tax aspect of it, look, nobody likes to have taxes raised, but a sales tax increase would affect everybody, so it's very evenly distributed. And you know, I would be willing to pay that half cent increase to keep our public transport running, because I'm a user of it. I need to use it. There's a lot of people in my area that need to use it. My area of the city, it sometimes gets ignored by the council and other political powers around here. I live just off of Los Feliz, which is not far from here. And as for the political aspect of it passing, if a certain gentleman with a very bad weave gets on the ballot later this year, we're going to get the votes for that, because people are going to turn out in force to stop that man. So it will definitely pass. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rashid. All right, and we will go back to Mr. Kettle. Do you have any comments to... Speaker? No. Then I would just ask for a motion to receive and file.
I would like to make the motion to receive and file the presentation by Executive Director of the VCTC, Darren Kettle.
Very good. Then vote, please.
That motion carries 5-0.
Thank you very much. On to item 9B. Department report. This is on the 2015 general plan and the housing element annual progress report, and we are going to hear from senior planner Jeffrey Spector, who's
had to get my microphone working.
All right, that's fine.
Hello, Mr.
and the
Mayor.
Esteemed John Prescott is
yes.
Up there as well.
Members of the City Council, this report was prepared in compliance with California law. State law requires all cities and counties to submit an annual report regarding their progress on their general plans and their general plan housing elements as well. The first part of the report that's in your packet describes the status and the progress that's been made in 2015 with respect to implementation of the general plan, including the land use element, the circulation element, and the open space element. The second part of the report is the housing element progress report, and it describes, among other things, the city's progress in meeting its share of the regional housing need. That report also includes, as again required by state law, a copy of the redevelopment agency, housing successor agency, annual report. And as far as the housing element progress report, the highlight is that we have issued building permits for the construction of 115 residences in 2015. So with that, I'll conclude, and just say that staff recommends that City Council receive and file this report and direct the Community Development Director to submit the reports to the various state agencies as required by state law. That concludes my presentation, and I'll answer questions, any questions you may have.
Very good. Questions? Ms. Bill De La Pena.
Thank you. Mrs. Spector, I have a question regarding the circulation element of the general plan.
Yes.
I wanted to confirm that the circulation element would preclude or would show that Rolling Oaks Drive would not be extended, and that came up 3 or 4 weeks ago when we heard an application for assisted living on Rolling Oaks Drive. I believe that the circulation element did not clearly show that that road was not supposed to actually go through, and Mr. Prescott mentioned at the time that we will update this, and I just wanted to make sure that that element is going to be updated, that particular road.
Well, I'm not sure whether we would do that right now. I suppose it could be the council's, it's at the council's discretion. Perhaps
correct.
Mr. Prescott can weigh in on what we might do to address that issue.
Yeah, I think our information is that by extending Holland Drive in 2001, that fulfilled the connection between Moore Park Road and Rancho Road. We did indicate in our staff report on the Oakmont project that from time to time, the city does basically cleanup amendments to the general plan to sort of refine things to match what, you know, what's really out there. And the next time that the city does that, we would include that minor map change. But the road was already constructed. There is no need for, there will be no requirement for any extension into Rolling Oaks from Rolling Oaks Drive.
Yeah, but is that reflected in the circulation element? From the way I see it, it is not.
Well, keeping in mind it's a general plan, and the general purpose was to have a connection between Rancho Road and Moore Park Road south of the freeway, and the road system that has been built fulfills that. So in our opinion, the general plan has been fulfilled. Again, it was in a slightly different location than was originally mapped back in 1970, was when that map was prepared. So the next time we do an amendment that involves changes in the mapping, then we'll include it.
You will do that then. Okay, and when will that be?
We don't have that scheduled. There really aren't that many identified areas of cleanup right now.
Okay, because the reason I mention it, because in the staff report it mentions the circulation element, so I thought that this would be the appropriate time to mention this. No?
Can I?
Was that a question that you were asking staff?
Yeah, that was a question.
Just to build on what Ms. Bilodeau is talking about, are we missing something here? It was council direction was very clear.
Yeah.
Okay. And I don't think Mr. Prescott's purposely doing it, but I'm getting a sense that somehow we're delaying this for some reason. Is there some reason, you know, this cleanup, whatever you're talking about, can't come back in like a month and let's just finish this?
Mr. Mayor, members of council, we will make sure we follow up as directed, and it'll be back before council. I'm not going to commit to a time right now, but as quickly as we can, we'll bring it back. It'll be on your agenda forecast.
Yeah, we'll get from the staff perspective, I totally get it. It's almost a boilerplate routine. We're just going to do it. I think there's an interest on the council to get this cleaned up sooner rather than later. And so I think it just serve everybody's interest if we just bring that back, even under consent. Let's just get it done.
Yeah, I would agree. I don't want to, should there be another project that come about at that same location, I don't want to be having to have the same conversation again.
Exactly.
So, okay, I think that's clear.
You need a motion for that, or?
I got it. It'll be done.
Okay. Very good. Then I am.
Is there any cards?
Any other questions?
Is there any cards?
There are no cards on 9B, no.
I'm going to move the staff recommendation 1 and 2 to receive the 2015 General Plan Housing Element Annual Progress Report.
Very good. Then vote, please.
That motion carries 5-0.
Very good. We're on to item 9C, to initiate an amendment to General Plan Land Use Element and allow concurrent processing of entitlement applications. And Mr. Spector is going to make that presentation as well.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor and members of the council. This is a proposal or a request to initiate an amendment to the General Plan Land Use Element and allow concurrent processing of entitlements for the property, and we'll describe that in a moment. The request is to amend the land use element designation from industrial to institutional, the purpose of which is to allow processing of a zone change and a special use permit for an assisted living facility. This is a general plan, a portion of a general plan. Land use map shows the property. It's located at the corner of Los Feliz Drive and Duesenberg Drive. This property is a little over 2 acres. It's vacant, and there is no impact with regard to Measure E in that it has no effect on general plan residential capacity or the amount of commercial land designated in the general plan. This is an aerial photo of the property. You can see that but for utility aspect, it's vacant. There's a number of trees on the west side. There's an Edison easement as well, power line easement. There have been at least 2 approvals that we know of for entitlements in the last number of years. An industrial building was approved in 98, and a mini warehouse building was approved in 2008. The applicant has informed staff that he met with property owners, the Westlake Hills Property Owners Association in particular, and received support, favorable feedback from the association. In addition, staff believes that this property is very well suited for this proposed use, the assisted living use. So staff's recommendation is that the council initiate the proposed amendment to the general plan land use element, allow concurrent processing of entitlements for an assisted living facility, and refer this to the Planning Commission for a recommendation. And that concludes my presentation.
Okay, questions of council? Mr. Adam?
No, I don't have any questions.
Oh, you do not?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Bill De La Pena does.
Yeah.
A quick question. So it is suggested that this be an about 86-bed facility that would be concurrently processed?
Well, we don't have the actual application now, but in my discussions with the applicant, we're looking in 80-plus range.
Okay.
I don't know the exact number.
All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We do have a number of speakers on 9C. We're going to start with, and forgive me if I butcher your last name there, Richard, is it Nice? Very good. Followed by Sean Isles?
Ellis.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor, members of the council. My name is Richard Nice. I'm with Griffin Real Estate Management. I represent the applicant tonight and the property owners. I'm also a resident here in Thousand Oaks. Griffin Real Estate Management is a local family-owned company, 110 years in California, Southern California, and we've been in the Canal Valley about 50 years, and so we're not strangers to your community. We're also proud to partner with the property owners, Mark and Debbie Reese, who are the residents here in town. They're also business owners, and they also own the adjacent property next door to this property in question. And they're planning to join us in this development of this assisted living facility, and our long-term plans are to jointly keep that facility between the Reese and the Griffin families for long-term hold. As staff has presented, we are requesting this change from industrial to institutional so that we may process, right now it's about an 86 unit or any 6-room facility for assisted living, and about 30 units would be for memory care, a separate memory care wing. We expect we'll be employing about 70 full-time people with 3 shifts a day, 70 in total, over 3 shifts a day. And our goal is to have, to serve the senior community who really have to have assistance in their daily life and to give them a good quality of life. And we see that as a very growing need in most of California. We had quite an outreach program going. We started in 2014, working with the community, also visiting with the city, understanding the process. And over the last 18 months, we have had 4 meetings with the neighborhood community. Can we get overhead? TOTV, maybe? There we go.
There it is.
And that's, let's turn it so it's correct. Turn it towards you. I think that's correct, right? Yeah. This is the West Hills neighbor, the West Hills residential community, representing over 600 homes. And we've met with them, like I said, 4 times, beginning in late November through last year, and then again this year in January. Our outreach program we presented to staff was about a 22-page program. We showed support cards, letters from the Homeowners Association, and support throughout those 18 months. Shall I stop? Okay. Sean
yes,
is going
to
pick up for me, and he'll finish up.
Very well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Neese and Sean Ellis.
Thank you so much for having us this evening. I'm Sean Ellis with Griffin Real Estate Management. And taking off from where Mr. Neese left off, we had a very successful outreach program in which we've been published in the Westlake Hills Echo, which is the WHPOA newsletter. And we've just been met with a lot of positivity from the community, and they seem to be very excited for this new development. And we'll take you on a brief photo tour of the area. So as you can see, the adjacent community is on the right side of the page with the property highlighted in green. And Rick is zooming out so you can see the full extent of the layout. And continuing, we're going to go down Duesenberg Drive, heading north right now. So right here is the post office on the corner of Duesenberg and Thousand Oaks Boulevard. Continuing on Duesenberg, we have a car wash and office type of structures. There's the car wash in that photo, actually. So there are commercial offices and properties of that nature as we continue down a dental plaza and more commercial buildings. And there is 77 Duesenberg Drive, which is the Reese property right now. Our partners are directly adjacent. And now towards the right side of the page, you can actually see our property, which is the only empty parcel on Duesenberg Drive. And continuing, we see more of the parcel and the adjacent WHPOA community. And that is at Clearwater and Duesenberg. So if you just take a right onto Clearwater, you are in the adjacent community. And continuing north, we have a view heading south of the property, and that is Los Feliz and Duesenberg Drive. And more similar structures on the other side of the property heading north. That is a medical office. And we have the fire department. That is Fire Station 31. And finally, similar structures. So That is the overview of the property. And like I said, we've had tremendously positive positive feedback. And here are some renderings of our proposal. And we have been in intimate discussions with the adjacent community regarding these renderings, and they've been met with significant initial approval. So, yeah, thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thank you, and I do want to thank you for your extensive outreach.
Thank you.
That's always helpful and beneficial for all parties involved. So
thank you for having us.
Next, we have. Oh, you do. Ms. Bill De La Pena has a question for
quick
one of
question,
you.
Quick question, Mr. Nice and Mr. Ellis or Hillis?
Ellis, please.
Ellis, okay.
Ellis.
Quick question. How many oak trees do you plan to remove?
We're not quite sure, Councilwoman. We have looked at the property. There are a lot of them on a slope that we're going to try to save. We think that will make a great surrounding area for our residents, but there are probably a few that will be removed. The probably not as many as the last approval, which I think had about five or
correct.
Seven oak trees that were approved
mm-hmm.
originally. But we're going to work hard to save them. We like oak trees. And
please do save them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very well. Ricky Whitman, followed by Linda Spencer.
Ricky Whitman, Westlake Hills Property Owners Association. I want to confirm, yes, we had several meetings with this company, and they've been very well received. The people liked what they heard and would like to support it. And we had to go from one meeting place to another to have a larger audience. Mm. And everybody that we talked to seemed to be in great favor. We think this is an excellent location, not only for us, but for the people that are going to be living there with the fire department nearby. We know how great the fire department is in helping in emergency situations. And we have voted for at the Homeowner Association in favor of this project, and we would like to see it completed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Linda Spencer will be followed by David Broyles. Good evening.
Mayor, council members, thank you so much for having us this evening and listening to what we have to say. I just want to echo what you've heard thus far. A couple of other things to take into consideration would be the fact that I know you've had a couple of other periods where you've been approached regarding assisted living facilities, and you didn't have the community's buy-in with these facilities. This time you do. And right now, there is a blank piece of land that is being used actually for heavy equipment storage right now, which if we had our chance to change that, Griffin Real Estate Management has been wonderful with regard to any from the smallest of details they're presenting to us to change with if it's aesthetics, if it's lighting, if it's we didn't like the number, the way the way it was set up, the number of beds that they were considering, they've been completely open, amiable, and changed every single thing that we had from the largest to the smallest concern. So I absolutely urge you to provide them with this change in what they need in order to move forward with regard to the zoning. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Ms. Spencer. Just to be clear, what the council would be taking action on is simply to allow concurrent processing. This isn't an approval of the project by any stretch of the imagination. It would be simply to allow them to process the entitlement applications and the zone change concurrently. So, So David Broyles, followed by Pren Knowlton.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, council members, for entertaining my opportunity to speak. My name is David Broyles, and I'm here with my wife, Azita, and we have been members or residents of Thousand Oaks Westlake for 30 years. We are generally in favor of the proposed assisted living development, but our concerns that we have to do with traffic that this project would likely cause. And we have seen the growth of traffic on Duesenberg, which is a problematic street because of the high traffic volume that transits the area, no doubt to get to Hillcrest, but because of the post office. And so for that reason, I would implore the people who are considering this to make egress only from Los Feliz and not allow the current driveway between the properties that the Reese family now owns directly across from Clearwater to be an exit onto Duesenberg, because that would further exacerbate the traffic situation that we are now facing, those of us trying to get out of Clearwater, out of the Westlake Hills community, onto Duesenberg, because oftentimes we have to wait long periods, feel like we're being held hostage because of the traffic volume. And my concern is that if that driveway is allowed to be an egress path, that would be could be a significant traffic problem. Secondly, I believe that intersection, Clearwater and Duesenberg, deserves a traffic light, because the current traffic solution that we've seen proposed by the in the proposed plans is a roundabout, and I don't believe that I have lots of experience with roundabouts, both locally and also overseas, and I don't believe that a roundabout is suitable for a traffic circle, if you will, suitable for that type of traffic volume at that location. And we believe that I believe a traffic light would be a much preferred solution, understanding that that cost would have to be borne by the developer. And thirdly, we believe that as a part of this solution, that the entrance to the community right there at Clearwater needs to be not just no parking, but no stopping. That signage needs to be changed to no stopping, because right now, if vehicles park or stop there with drivers inside the vehicles, and you're coming around the corner, one of these days there's going to be a significant rear-end collision. And we have delivery vehicles and other types of vehicles that stop there, and it's a significant traffic hazard. So I throw that in as part of this solution, the traffic solution. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Again, I do need to stress that like the last gentleman, you will have an opportunity if this project goes forward. There will be a public hearing, and most of those details will probably be worked out through the process, but we'd love to have you back and have those comments made at the public hearing if and when this project goes forward too. So Pren Knowlton, followed by Marcia Knowlton.
Good evening, Mayor and Council, and thank you very much for the opportunity to address you. Living in this area for over 20 years, and that has been a quiet piece of land for a long time, and it's refreshing to see it being put to use, and I would see it as quiet use for a senior facility, and perhaps many of the people currently living in our community might become residents, and there would be close to be able to visit them, but enlarge our community. Also, I can bring one unique point of experience. I was a student at Harvard University. I live back in the East Coast, and I've experienced what they call rotaries, which is a synonym for roundabout. I've seen them scattered here and there in California, and I think they're a wonderful safety feature. I think we need traffic to slow down, especially when we're talking about young parents taking their small children to and from. It could become a bellwether for better traffic safety throughout Thousand Oaks, because I'm not aware of many roundabouts. And also traffic would be more smooth and flowing. I could also add that having driven down Duesenberg at night to make my turn on Clearwater, it's not easy to see exactly where that turn is. The presence of a roundabout would make that more visible at night, and at the same time, I think it would save costs instead of putting in another traffic signal. I think it could add an architectural interest that makes Thousand Oaks the unique community that it is. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Marcia Knowlton, followed by Sherry Knox. Good evening.
My name is Marcia Knowlton, and I've lived in Westlake Hills for 33 years, and I love it there. And the traffic has gotten really bad. However, everything I've seen about this senior care facility looks like a really good idea. And it's the first good idea that's come along in 33 years for that empty dirt lot. So I support it 150%. Hope you do too for that switch.
Thank you, ma'am. All right, Sherry Knox, followed by Tony Gitt.
Good evening, Council. Thank you for taking the time to listen to what I have to say. I've been living in this city for pretty much my whole life, and am currently living in the Westlake Hills community, the Octagon, right by off of Clearwater. And I think that changing the zoning from industrial to institutional was a really positive change to our community. I think that it's a beautiful building. I don't know if you guys have seen it. I think they showed it. It is beautiful to look at. It's not going to be as much traffic as what an industrial building can be. And I think it's going to bring nothing but quiet, good to our neighborhood. So that's pretty much it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And our final speaker, Tony Gitt.
Mayor Price, members of the council. My name is Tony Gitt. I live in the Westlake Hills section of Thousand Oaks. I'm here tonight to support the Griffin Project because there is an urgent need, in my opinion, and I think all of your opinions, to provide senior support and facilities in the city here. My home in Westlake Hills on Sawtooth Court backs up directly to Duesenberg. The proposed site of this assisted living memory care facility will place the rear of my home facing approximately to the center of the facility. Previous proposals of this site included a business park, a storage for new cars, and it's been used in the past to sell Christmas trees as well as setting off fireworks on the 4th of July. It's currently used to store the heavy equipment for the undergrounding of the utilities on T.O. Boulevard. The developer has held several meetings, as he mentioned, with us. And he's listened to us, and he's made amendments and changes as needed. I particularly like the idea of having a traffic roundabout or circle at the intersection of Duesenberg and Clearwater to mitigate the traffic and speeding that already exists on Duesenberg during rush hours. Also, it's important that the perception of this council and the city is anti-senior friendly. The recent denial of the Oakmont Assisted Living Facility and two more prior failures for assisted living facilities in the city has sent a clear message to the development community. The Griffin Project is an opportunity to start to rebuild the city's reputation as being senior friendly. I urge you not only to approve the planning for this project to proceed, but also to provide positive support along the way to actually make this happen rather than have a denial at the end of the process. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gitt. Go back to staff. Any follow-up, Mr. Spector?
I think we've covered the ground very well.
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, very well. Then, yes, Mr. Adam? Question?
All right, we're done with public comments then?
Yes.
All right, thank you very much.
I do want to say that I have four written statement cards, all in favor of the project.
Very good. Well, I think this project looks like it's off to a very good start. I want to commend the builders for their community outreach. So far, so good, I would say. And I've been around long enough to see alternate proposals for this piece of land, and I would tend to agree that this one would be probably the more superior of the ones I've seen. The zone change looks appropriate. We're in the beginning process, so we'll have to run it all the way through, but good start. And, you know, since we're on the subject of assisted living, I just want to take a moment to correct a misconception that seems to be floating around the community. And it has to do with two senior assisted living projects that were proposed a year or two ago. One was on the north side of Hillcrest on a piece of property that was owned by a private individual who happened to be a developer. And one was on the south side of Hillcrest on a piece of property owned by many mansions. And both parcels were being proposed for assisted living projects. And both of these projects got into our community development department, and the planning was started. But for a number of reasons, public opposition and a few other reasons, both projects were abandoned by the private developer and many mansions long before they hit the Planning Commission, and they never hit City Council. So obviously, if these projects didn't come before us, we couldn't vote against them. Is that, everybody understand that? Okay. Second point, Many Mansions has been an affordable housing and a senior-friendly organization in this town for many years, and this council is a very strong supporter of Many Mansions. We went so far as to reimburse Many Mansions a significant amount of the money that they spent in the Community Development Department to push this assisted living project forward in good faith. So, again, City Council did not vote against two senior assisted living projects. They never got to us. All right. Just want to clear that up. And with that, I would like to make a motion that we grant concurrent processing for the Duesenberg Drive and Los Feliz senior assisted living project.
Very well. Any other comments? Hearing none. You do have a comment, Ms. Bill Lepena.
Yes, the comment that I would like to make is that it is an excellent move on the part of the builder to reach out to the community at an early stage and not wait until the last minute. So this makes this project very different, as well as its location for assisted living. What I would like to make sure is that you continue the outreach with your immediate neighbors. I know that Westlake Hills Homeowners Association seems to be in support of it. And I believe, is it Westlake Hills that did vote, or is it the Westlake Joint Board that vote? That was the only thing where I was a little confused. As long as Westlake Hills Homeowners Association voted on this, I think that would be great. They did. Okay. West Hills.
Westlake Hills.
Okay, very good. Just wanted to make sure, because sometimes with the Westlake Joint Board, they do represent many, many HOAs, but unless you, when you are a member and you do read your emails and the summary minutes from Marsha Knowlton, people really don't know exactly what's going on. So, and I do appreciate your hard work over the many, many years, Marsha, that you've been the, I believe, the secretary for the Westlake Joint Board. So very good. That makes me feel even better that the immediate neighbors have voted on this, and it seems unanimously, and even if it isn't unanimously, but it seems that there is a lot of support. So I do want to thank you for the outreach and urge you to continue to do that. Thanks. And I will support the motion.
Very well. Then vote, please.
The motion carries 5-0.
Very well. Then we're up to item number 12, and that is follow-ups from meetings or conferences, and I think that would be me. As I mentioned earlier, I spent a week in Washington, D.C., attending National League of Cities conference there. Prior to the conference, we met with, as I again mentioned earlier, Congresswoman Julia Brownlee herself, just expressed our federal interests to her, and exchanged information. Always good to get back there to D.C. and have that conversation personally. We also met with representatives from Senators Boxer and Feinstein's office, and again laid out our federal agenda with them. We met with the USDA to talk about a couple of pests that are working their way northbound from the San Diego area and San Bernardino counties that are impacting oak trees. The polyphagous shot hole borer and the oak bark beetle are killing the trees, and we need to do what we can. So we got some educational information, and at some point in the very near future, we'll be educating our residents about how we might prevent those pests from getting up here into our beautiful oaks that we have. Met with the National Endowment for the Arts, discussed different projects that and funding for projects that pop up music events and pop up art festivals that hopefully we will be submitting grants for at some point in the near future. I also met with the Library of Congress, the head of the recorded sound section, had a really good conversation about our radio archives and how we might best catalog them, make them available for the public to be able to enjoy. So at the same time, I was there for public safety and crime prevention meeting. I served as the vice chair of that committee. We had a lengthy discussion, a joint meeting with one of the other committees on the opioid issue that is an absolute plague to this country, not just to our area here, but not just statewide, but the entire country. That is going to be one of our work items for this year, and I look forward to engaging some of our residents to find out what ideas they might have. So more to come on that. In all, it was a great trip, a great conference, and I look forward to those every year. It's a great opportunity for Thousand Oaks to be recognized in our nation's capital. So that is all I have. City Manager, follow-up, please.
Mr. Mayor, members of the council, by way of follow-up, we did have a speaker at the beginning who talked about the cannabis effort, and I was reminded by our staff that the city staff is working with county staff on this effort in terms of the stakeholder effort. So we'll be happy to follow up with an individual who spoke and let them know of our participation. So next council meeting is coming up on April 12th, and at this point in time, we're looking at a couple public hearings. The continuation of the Lowe's item, the signage issue, that's coming, and another hearing, water and wastewater rates and user fees. So those will be the two public hearings at this time. We also have a one department report, and that's a open space parcel, small open space parcel acquisition off of Skyline. And then potentially a recommendation for the fifth planning commissioner appointment that might come to council. Also, we'd like to encourage the public as well as city council and city employees to take a look at the shows that are coming up in the theaters. We've had a very successful last few weeks with full houses and a whole variety of opportunities, concerts, distinguished speaker series. We've got the newest symphony coming up. We have Cabrillo coming up. So. Theater League, very exciting with respect to the shows that are coming up in both theaters. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Mitnick. That takes us to our adjournments this evening. We are adjourning tonight's City Council meeting in memory of Jonathan J.T. Taukus, who passed away February 28th. Jonathan, or J.T. as he was known to friends, was a stage worker for the city since 2013. His talents as a technician and lighting designer contributed to the success of numerous Civic Arts Plaza productions and presentations. He had a keen interest in the latest lighting technology, was a quick learner, had become a backup to the department's head electrician, and candidate to one day become one of our crew leaders. Jonathan had a special gift and passion for lighting design and was very excited to make his life work be about new uses in lighting and technology. JT was a resident of Simi Valley, a graduate of Santa Susana High School, and studied at Los Angeles City College, and was also an accomplished musician. JT was a generous young man with an enthusiasm to mentor other young people interested in the arts. Following in the creative footsteps of his stepmother, Monica, father, Dave, and mom, Kathy. Besides being both a wonderful son and grandson, he had many friends and was respected and highly regarded by his co-workers at the city, his teachers, mentors, and arts community. Jonathan will be sorely missed. I see that we have Michael Tashko and Jonathan Surrett from the Cultural Affairs Department to say a few words about JT.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, city staff. I also wanted to acknowledge JT's dad, who's here this evening, Dave. And thank you very much for allowing us to this opportunity to remember JT. He was a stagehand, worked in both of the venues, mostly as a lighting engineer. When JT first came to us, he had He did some really creative things in school, and he had an extraordinary enthusiasm. He had a vision for each event that he would work on, whether it was a dance recital or a human resources all staff meeting. JT had a vision for what that should look like, and you'd find him up in the catwalk frequently, moving things around. If we couldn't find him, he'd generally be upstairs trying to make it look like his show. Sometimes he may have been even a little over-enthusiastic, but it wasn't long before he realized what we needed from him, and more importantly, what our customers needed. And he adapted, learned to apply his talents and his experience to the needs of the members of the greater arts community who use the venues. In the process of doing this, he wasn't just making good lighting looks. He was building confidence, and confidence in himself, confidence that we had in him, and he was building the trust of our customers. He had gotten to the point where he was making a really significant contribution, and he had begun to substitute for some of our more senior engineers and technicians. Not long after learning of his passing, one of his fellow employees said to me, "You know, he was just a good kid, and JT was a good kid, but he was a good kid well on his way to being a good man, and we will miss him."
Mr. Mayor, members of council, as Michael had mentioned, we appreciate you giving us this opportunity to honor one of our technicians. JT was very talented, as Michael has pointed out. He was good and he knew it. But along with that, he was also dependable and incredibly trustworthy. And one of the stories that I recounted at his celebration of life this past week was that as Michael and I sit across the table from prospective candidates for our stagehand positions, a lot of things go into the decision that you make whether to hire that person or not. And it's not always about talent or achievement. A lot of it has to do with personality. And just sitting across the table from this 18-year-old kid who is fresh out of Santa Susana High School, you can tell that he had a creative spark about him and an incredible passion for what he really loved to do. One of the personal stories that I was mentioning at his celebration of life as well is that when you have two Jonathans in a department, sometimes it can get a little confusing. And although he did opt to be called JT by all of his colleagues, I always simply referred to him as the young one. But although he's gone, and he was only with us for a very short amount of time, the theater here is better off for having had him in it, albeit for the shortened amount of time that we did. And his loss, or our loss rather, is tremendous. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. We are also adjourning tonight's City Council meeting in memory of Marie Harris, who passed away February 22nd. Marie is a retired City of Thousand Oaks employee. She worked in the Community Development Department from 1977 to 1995, retiring as a senior administrative secretary. Marie was born in Buffalo, New York, and grew up in South Portland, Maine. She and her family moved to Glendale in the early 40s. While working as a secretary for Shell Oil, she met her husband-to-be, Godfrey Harris, at an Armistice Day dance at the Hollywood Palladium in 1945. Godfrey was a Marine, and when he left the service, he worked for Burroughs Corporation, first in Pasadena, then in Westlake Village. The family moved to Westlake Village in 1970, and Marie took care of their young children. In 1977, Marie put her business college skills to work when she joined the city's planning department and was one of the first clerical staff to make the transition from typewriters to the new word processors of the day. Maria is remembered for her beautiful smile and warm heart and for her contributions to the smooth operation of the department and city during a time of rapid growth and change. She is survived by husband Godfrey, daughter Paula, also a former city employee, her son Bradford, and three grandchildren. And with that, we will be in adjournment until our next scheduled meeting on Tuesday, April 12th. Good night.